range of flying, warping, and manipulating robots.
All right, great, thanks. All right, I didn't even have to do anything yet. This is great. You're my kind of crowd. How are you guys doing? How's the summer school going?
Good.
Cool. So, I'm going to talk primarily about trajectory optimization today, and with a special emphasis on sort of thinking about the nonlinear dynamics of systems in an optimization context. But I thought I would just at least have one slide motivating why we should care about dynamics. So I guess there are a lot of interesting robotics tests about which you don't really have to reason about the dynamics of the system. So a lot of sort of standard manipulation tasks or industrial robots that like weld car frames together and things like this. You can often think about solving these sort of control problems, thinking about the kinematics of the system and doing like high gain feedback and so on. But there are many interesting tasks, some of which you guys might care a lot about, that require careful consideration of the dynamics when you're doing control design. And as a subset of these systems, which are what we call underactuated, that really emphasize the need to think about dynamics. So I'll start today at a sort of really basic level, just because I know there's probably a wide variety of backgrounds sitting in the room. And we'll talk about, dynamics, control is a way to manipulate dynamics of systems. What does underactuation mean at a high level? And then we'll start getting into more of the algorithmic tools that we tend to use to control these sort of systems. So, in terms of dynamic tasks that certainly require thinking about the dynamics, so you can think about, running, jumping, these kind of things, right? So these are some of the sort of problems that we like to think about in my lab. But even in terms of manipulation, balancing, there's all kinds of things that would require us to think more carefully about the dynamics. So to start, I think it's useful to start with the simplest robot, okay? So you could argue about whether this is the simplest robot, but I would say it's right up there. So this is just a simple pendulum, right? And so we can look at this and start to say things about its dynamics. So we can, of course, animate the sort of forward simulation of such a system like this. Or we can draw pictures that describe its dynamics, and this is nice because it's a very low-dimensional system. We can draw things like this, which is called the phase diagram, where if I take the angle of the pendulum and also look at its angular velocity, plot that on the y-axis, I can say that this particular trajectory that you're seeing is starting in at the end of that blue curve on the x-axis. Sorry, I'm kind of constrained to the podium for the camera, but I would normally be walking around more. So you can see it sort of starts out here with some positive angle and zero velocity. Gravity starts pulling down on the thing, and so it starts accumulating a negative velocity. Gets to this point, right? It goes up here. At some point, it's going to stop, have zero velocity, and then become positive, and it's going to sort of spiral down towards the center because, in this particular case, we have some damping. So we have maybe a rusty hinge on our pendulum or something like that. So this is sort of a couple ways you can already start to think about the dynamics of a system like this. We can also sort of think about it algebraically, right? So I can define the state of a system like this as, a vector of the positions and velocities. I can look at the inputs. In this case, maybe I can apply torques to that hinge. And then I can write down the equations of motion of a system like this. And you've all, I'm sure, seen the equations of motion for a pendulum in your physics classes. But we can write them in some generic form like this, where we have x dot is equal to f of x u, where f is, in general, some nonlinear function of x and u. Okay, so this is the sort of general algebraic, structure we'll be using for the entire talk today, but I thought I'd introduce it with this very simple system. So let's think about control. What if I told you, instead of having that pendulum stabilized to the bottom, I want you to design a controller, pi, which takes in the current state, outputs some torque at the hinge, such that it stabilizes at the top. What's a simple idea to do that? Doesn't require any math, and you can describe the controller in words. Why does it stabilize at the bottom? Gravity. Okay. So that's sort of nature's controller on the pendulum. So we could design a controller that does what? Cancels out gravity and points it the other way. Sure. That's a really simple controller, right? And in fact, we can write a controller like that, run it on the pendulum, redraw our phase portrait, redraw our animations, and we get something that's completely different. So the thing, the way I want you to think about control in a generic sense is using some input to the system to reshape the phase diagram, to reshape how the dynamics evolve through time. Now, in this case, we sort of hit the dynamics with a hammer and say, I'm going to completely cancel out physics and do what I want, right? So that's a particular kind of control, which is not super elegant, right? Sort of overriding the dynamics of the system in some sense. But I could ask other questions too, right? If I said, give me a controller that instead minimizes the torque while also getting to the top. Can you describe that one in words? It's not as easy, right? How exactly would you write down a function that, you know, maps every state of the pendulum to the correct torque that's going to sort of globally minimize torque while getting it to the top? It turns out it's a really easy problem to solve, and I'll show you the tools to do that. But it's sort of a computational answer now. Now, if we go one step further and say I'm going to add one more link to my system, so I have this sort of double pendulum, and then I'm going to delete a motor, right? So I'm just going to have one actuator that's sitting at the elbow, nothing at the shoulder. Okay, so now I can ask you the same question. How do I control this system so that it stabilizes at the vertical position? Less obvious, right? Can't use my invert gravity trick anymore because I would never be able to exactly cancel out the torques that are being applied to the shoulder joint via gravity, right? So I have to be a little bit more clever. You might even be asking, is it possible, if you haven't seen a system before, that you could somehow stabilize the system at the top without having an actuator in the shoulder? Turns out you can. This is the sort of simplest example of an underactuated system, right? So intuitively, what you can think of an underactuated meaning is that I can't arbitrarily accelerate my system from any state, right? So if I'm in this particular state of the system, I can't just apply some torque to my actuators that is going to accelerate in any direction I want. I have to instead come up with control strategies that work with the inherent dynamics of the system to achieve goals, okay? And so this is sort of the more general class of systems that we often encounter in robotics. And just so you're convinced, at least with an example, you can, in fact, design a control strategy to swing up and balance at the top. We'll talk about all the tools you need to do that today. Now, you might be wondering, okay, so you're talking about robots where you're deleting motors and things like that. Stop making life hard for yourself and get off of this underactuated topic. Well, it turns out there are just some systems that are fundamentally underactuated. It's not because we're lazy and didn't include all the motors that we should. So if I took the Acrobot system, pulled it off the wall, and stuck it on the ground, now you have a sort of the simplest model of a walking system, right? And this is underactuated because, you know, for example, I can't apply torques to the ground, I can't pull against the ground, and so on. So I have these sort of unilateral interaction with the ground. Okay, so I have to sort of work with the passive dynamics of the system in order to achieve goals, okay? So that's the sort of theme of the ideas that we're talking about today. And just to get this out of the way, if you don't have underactuated systems, doesn't matter. These are still important tools that you might want to use because you might want to, you know, come up with control strategies that minimize the effort of your system, or you might want to make systems move really quickly such that they take advantage of Coriolis effects and all kinds of things like that. So if you want really high performance behavior, even out of systems that have motors on all their degrees of freedom, these are still useful tools. Okay, so there are a lot of ways, many of you have probably played around different ways to design controllers for robots. There's heuristic methods, right, so you sit there and tune gains, whatever. There's sort of virtual model methods, right, embed some simple physical model in my device and then design controllers for that. Programming by demonstration and so on. What we're gonna advocate for is a sort of optimization view of control. And it's, on one hand, a really powerful set of tools because it allows me to describe in sort of plain terms what the goals of my system are, what the relevant constraints of my system are, and then hand them to sort of more or less off-the-shelf optimization algorithms to compute solutions for me. So I think there's been a trend in you know, maybe you guys are all mostly young, so this probably seems pretty obvious to you, but you know, over the last 10 or so years in robotics has really been an uptick in how much optimization is actually used for control and other things. So let's talk about the optimal control problem in generic terms. So I'm gonna start not sort of with trajectory optimization. I'm gonna start with the problem that we sort of really want to solve, and then we'll look at what the sort of computational ramifications of that are, and that's gonna help us motivate the need for trajectory optimization. So ultimately, what I would love is a policy that maps me from any reachable state of my robot to the optimal action, optimal in the sense that it minimizes some cost, okay? And we'll talk about sort of finite horizon costs here. You can think about infinite horizon as well. But this is generally gonna be some function where I have some final costs on some state. So maybe I wanna get to some goal position at time n, and then I have a one-step cost on both the state and action at time step k, for k ranges from 0 to n minus 1. And these can encode obvious things, right? Minimize torque squared, you know, get to the goal very quickly, and so on. So, usually these functions are relatively unsurprising. And I want to do this, of course, subject to the dynamic constraints of my system, right? And so in all the methods we'll talk about today, we're going to be thinking about sort of discrete time representations of dynamics, where I have a function that maps from my current state and input to my next state, okay? Now, I'm sure most of you have done this kind of thing before, but just in case you haven't, you know, mapping from something that's in sort of continuous time to this discrete time version is pretty straightforward, and there's many ways you could think about doing that, but suppose I had some continuous time description of my nonlinear dynamics, like a pendulum, and maybe I had some integrative costs and so on. I can map that into a sort of approximate discrete time version of the problem by, you know, picking an appropriate time step, you know, doing an approximation of this integral with a sum, and picking an integration rule like Euler integration. Of course, you can pick higher order things here if you want as well, but this is sort of like the simplest thing. Make sense? Everyone on board so far? Kind of defining the problem that we want to solve in generic terms? Okay, let's think about a specific example. Imagine I have this little RC aircraft. This is actually one of the ones we have in our lab. And imagine I want it to come up with a controller to do a reliable 180-degree barrel roll, okay? So in order to define an optimal control problem, there's a few things I have to make sure are squared away. First is I need to define what the state of the system is. In this case, we'll just say that the state is the floating base position and rotation and the time derivative of both of those quantities. And then maybe the input has to do with control commands to the throttle on the front and the control surfaces, the ailerons, rudder and elevators and so on. I can write down a cost function. This is something I invent, but it might be, you know, get to this flipped upside down angle, right, at time step n, and then do that while minimizing control inputs over time. Okay, so this is a really simple, you know, hopefully intuitive specification of an optimal control problem. So let's think about what it would mean to compute a policy that solves this problem from basically anywhere in the reachable state space. So if I was here, at say time step 2, I find myself in state x where x is something up here. If I were to ask you, okay, what's the optimal input to all of your control surfaces and your throttle such that over the entire time horizon you minimize cost, meaning hopefully you get to that rotated position? It's a hard question to intuitively answer, right? Because sort of the decision here has to do with the sort of total time evolution of the closed loop system. Right, it has to know what's going to happen into the future, right? So it's really not obvious what to do here, but if I were to ask you what to do here, so I'm in some state with one time step to go, what's the optimal thing to do? It's maybe more obvious, right? It's sort of like, okay, go straight as close as you can, you know, as hard as you can to try to get to that final cost, right? So you can build on this intuition to define an algorithm to actually compute these policies for you, right? So we're going to work backwards in time. That's the idea. Okay, so we'll take that intuition and let's do it out in some algebra. So this is just our cost function that we defined to specify the problem. We're going to define this quantity called the optimal value function, also called the optimal cost to go. I'll probably accidentally swap between those two things fluidly as I speak, but just know that I mean the same thing. And what this tells you is, this is the lowest possible accumulated cost remaining if I start in state x at time step n and follow the optimal policy. Okay, so this is, if someone hands you the optimal policy, this is a function that's basically going to tell you what state and time step pairs are sort of better or worse than one another. Okay? So let's think about how would you, you know, let's not talk about how to compute this yet, but let's see if we can make a sort of algebraic statement about what this is, okay? So let's start at time step n. If I'm at the end of time, there's nothing to do, right? I can't do anything. I can't apply a control action and see where I end up. It's sort of, no, that's the end of the task as we've defined it. So this function, when whatever state we have here at time step capital N, is just going to be the final cost. Make sense, right? There's nothing we can do. Okay, so that's good. So that's a sort of starting point for defining this function. What if we go one time step back from there? what's the optimal thing to do? All right, and this is building on that sort of intuition we have with the airplane, right? It's saying that if you can only do one thing, you have one time step, what you're gonna do is pick the input such that it minimizes your one step cost plus the final cost of the state you'd end up in under your dynamics, right? It's gonna say, you know, you have one time step, pick the best you in terms of the sum of these two cost quantities. Make sense? So that's pretty straightforward as well. We can go one time step further back, and now we have to optimize over a sequence of two inputs such that it minimizes the one step cost for, you know, time step n minus two, and then time step n minus one, and then the final state, where again, all of these states are coming by running our control input through the dynamics. Now, you might have noticed this guy and this guy are exactly the same statement. So in fact, what we have is a recursive equation that describes the optimal value function for a given state and time step in terms of the optimal value function in terms of the optimal value function at the resulting state and the following time step. Okay? So this is called Bellman's equation. So how many people have seen Bellman's equation before? Good. So this is a very well-known relationship, and the thing that's cool about it is it leads to an algorithm, which we'll talk about in a second. But all this is right now is a statement about what the optimal value function must satisfy. Okay, the reason why this thing is a cool thing to compute, right, it might be just like, you know, is this an academic exercise, you know, to compute this optimal value function? Well, the reason you would want this thing is now you can compute the optimal action from any state via a one-step minimization. Okay, so if someone hands you an optimal value function, you're done, right? You have the optimal controller effectively, as long as this minimization isn't prohibitive. Okay, quick quiz. Suppose my cost function that I'm defining for my optimal control problem is quadratic in x and u. Is my value function quadratic? No? Who said no? Yeah, why not? Right, because we have our nonlinear dynamics sort of sitting in here, right? So my states are being transformed through some general nonlinear dynamics, so there's no reason to expect that my cost-to-go function is gonna be quadratic just because my cost function is, okay? So no. Okay, does Bellman's equation hold for multiplicative costs? So instead of having a cost function that sums costs over all the time steps, I want something that can multiply costs over all the time steps. Does Bellman's equation still work? Let's look at how we derived it. Would this step still work? No. This sort of sneaky substituting in of the minimization is only working because these things are additive. So in fact, in general, no. Actually, we require that the costs are going to be additive. Okay. So that's why you often see additive costs and optimal control. Cool. Questions so far? Yes. What's that?
So we can't use multiplicative costs in the Bellman's equation formulation. Are multiplicative costs, are they practically relevant?
Not usually. Yeah. So almost everything that we want to do in terms of optimal control, we can write down as an additive cost. This is just something to think about where the Bellman's equation comes from and what the requirements and the cost function might be. Okay. So clearly this thing's useful, so we want to compute it. Okay, so most of you have seen dynamic programming before, so you know this. So we can just take that equation and turn it into an update rule where we have some approximation to the value function in any given iteration. We're gonna iterate over all of our states. We're going to apply this as an update rule to our value function, and then just keep rinsing and repeating this until the value function converges. The problem with this sort of vanilla form of this algorithm is that I have to discretize my state space and represent this thing as a big table. And that's not bad for small systems like a pendulum or something like Acrobat, things like this. But for a humanoid robot, this is a problem. Why? Because, well, the number of discretized states is in general going to be exponential in the dimensionality of my robot, right? So that means even though this turns out to be a polynomial algorithm in the number of states, the number of states themselves, if I'm doing discretization, is going to grow exponentially with the dimensionality of the robot, okay? So that's sad. That means we can't just take this beautiful, easy to understand algorithm and just apply it to most of the systems that we care about. Some caveats here, you can, of course, instead of discretizing state spaces, you can try to do function approximation, approximate dynamic programming, things like this. But in general, it's been prohibitive to try to scale these sort of vanilla dynamic programming techniques to complicated systems. So we have this exponential bullet problem, so that's why we're not just solving, you know, dynamic programming. What if we instead settled for local policies that are around a particular trajectory, around a particular behavior in the system? So then it leads to two questions. Which trajectory and how local, right? Or how does this sort of feedback around this trajectory even work? Okay, so these are the sort of things we're gonna try to answer next. So the first algorithm I'd like to talk about, which is based very strongly on dynamic programming, is called differential dynamic programming. And this has a long history in the optimal control literature going back to the 60s and 70s, but recently has been used, you know, a lot in the robotics literature. So this is among the sort of fastest known techniques for doing trajectory optimization currently. So let me tell you how it works. So the input to this algorithm is going to be an initial state and initial guess of input sequence. So these can be torques to your motors, and it might be something smart, might be something stupid, like random or whatever. What I'm gonna do is start at this initial state, simulate my dynamics forward using this input sequence, and that's gonna give me then a state trajectory, right, that is dynamically feasible because I'm just simulating the system forward. Then what I'm gonna do is start at the end, and I'm gonna try to make little approximations to my cost to go, to my value function. And the way that this is gonna work is through a second order Taylor expansion of the sort of, the minimizing argument of the Bellman equation, which we'll see in a second. So I have these little quadratics, and then I'm going to say, okay, for each of these little quadratics, I'm gonna use the Bellman idea and say, what if I just minimize this sort of one step cost plus my approximation of the cost to go, and choose some input that pushes me towards the bottom of that bowl, right? So I'm gonna keep doing that recursively backwards in time. So then I have a bunch of corrections to my initial control tape that hopefully push me towards the bottom of these little quadratic approximations to the cost to go, okay? So I'm gonna solve a bunch of little quadratic minimizations backwards in time until I get to the beginning. Now I have a bunch of control corrections, and I'm gonna simulate the system forward with this new control tape. And that's gonna give me a new trajectory that hopefully has lower cost. And then I'm gonna rinse and repeat this until the trajectory converges to a local minima. Does this high level idea make sense to people? Let me know if it doesn't. Yes. Yeah, we'll go through the math in a sec. But basically it's a Taylor expansion is all we're doing. You're saying, why solve a sequence of small minimization problems rather than one big one? Is that what you're asking?
What's the motivation?
Well, so this is saying, can I use the sort of Bellman idea so that I can just do these sort of one-step minimizations to improve my policy with respect to an approximate value function, right? The sort of same way that like a DP-like algorithm would work. But I'm gonna do that sort of locally around this trajectory using little Taylor approximations, right? Rather than having to try to represent it in value function over the entire state space. That's the idea. Any other questions about this? Cool. So a couple pieces of terminology. So later I'll call this piece the forward pass, which is just the sort of simulation of the system forward with the current control tape. And the backwards pass is gonna be this sort of quadrization and update to the controls backwards in time. Okay, so this is the sort of function we're gonna define that is gonna give us our little local quadratic approximation. So here, at some given x and u along our trajectory, I can write this q function in terms of perturbations of x and u. And so this is gonna tell me how perturbations map to the one-step cost plus the value, right? And this is being mapped through my dynamics, right? And so this is going to, in general, if we weren't doing any kind of approximation, this is going to be some nonlinear, non-convex function in general, right? Because of the nonlinearity of our dynamics. So what we're going to do instead is say, well, if I want to minimize this Q function with respect to delta X, delta U, well, instead I'm going to take this little local quadratic approximation where zero, again, in terms of deltas, comes from our current nominal trajectory. And I'm going to do one-step minimizations on this quadratic and rinse and repeat. So what does this quadratic function look like? Well, it's algebraically going to look something like this, where each of these terms is going to be, you know, like a Hessian, where it's, you know, the second derivative of that Q function with respect to X and U and U and U and so on. So this is just sort of boring, you know, matrix calculus. There's nothing really fancy here, but it's not exactly the sort of thing you dump on a slide. So yeah, at a high level, this is the sort of thing we're actually doing minimization on with respect to U. So we have we start all the way at the end of time, N. I do this sort of approximation, and now I have a convex quadratic function that I want to minimize with respect to delta U. Right? I want to find what change to my input is going to sort of minimize this convex quadratic approximation of the cost to go. Well, I can just set the derivative equal to zero and then solve for delta U. And then what I'm going to have now is a function of delta U that, this delta U is a function of my local approximation of the cost to go plus changes in X. So this actually gives me back a local feedback policy on what the optimal action is, which is kind of cool. Now, what we're going to do to iterate backwards is take this delta U, substitute it into the approximation at the previous time step, and then we can rinse and repeat. So there's an iterative way to just go backwards in time from the final time step, compute all these control corrections, so you're going to have a sequence of these K matrices and a sequence of these feed-forward inputs, and then we're going to use those in the forward pass. So now we're going to start at our same initial state that we started from originally. And now I can use this feedback term plus my feed-forward input to re-simulate my system forward in time, which is going to give me, in general, a new trajectory, which hopefully reduces costs. There's some, you know, tricks you have to play in general to make sure that that always happens. We're going to run this forward until this whole thing converges. And what does converge mean? Well, maybe that the maximum control correction at a particular iteration is really small, right? So you're sort of not making many changes anymore. Questions. Does everyone get the sort of, all I want you to walk away with is sort of a high level idea of how this relates to dynamic programming and what it gives you, right? So this is going to give you a locally optimal trajectory and a local linear feedback policy to track that trajectory, right? That's all it's giving you. It's not giving you the same thing as dynamic programming, but it's working on the same sort of computational principles. Yes. Yeah. Well, so you're going to get a delta U. So you're going to get basically a feedback policy, which is a K matrix, which is a function of your time step, right? And a feed forward input. So you're going to have control corrections for every single time step, right? Not just at the first time step. Does that make sense? So it's a time varying feedback policy where my K is now a function of the time step. K gets multiplied by the difference between the X I'm actually seeing due to this forward simulation and my X from the previous time step, plus some feed forward correction as well. They have to be differentiable, right? Because they're doing Taylor expansions, so I need to be able to take gradients of my dynamics, and I need to be able to take gradients of my cost function. It doesn't require that the cost function is quadratic or convex or anything like that, although many papers you'll see people do end up using quadratic cost functions, in which case taking the Hessian is straightforward. You just take the quadratic matrix right out. Any other questions about this? Okay. So in practice, when people say DDP in the literature, they almost always are referring to a variant called iterative LQR, and there's sort of a detail, but just to be aware of it, when you had those terms that were like QXX, which is like the second derivative of this Q function with respect to X and U and so on, that requires, in general, taking the second derivative of your dynamics. Now, think about it, your dynamics is a vector-valued function. So I take the derivative of my dynamics with respect to my states and inputs. That's going to be a matrix, a Jacobian, right? And if I take the second derivative, that's a third-rank tensor. Okay, that's a lot of numbers to compute, and it's very expensive. So in practice, what people do is they just say, I'm just gonna leave that off, right? And there's actually a really nice theoretical conceptualization of what that means. So it sort of like goes from being a Newton method to a Gauss-Newton method, and it changes the theoretical convergence properties of the algorithm. But basically speaking, it's sort of the same. We haven't really talked about constraints in this algorithm, and oftentimes it's not described in a way that handles constraints. So oftentimes people will just add additional cost functions that'll be sort of penalties for violating your constraints. So as long as you don't really care about satisfying your constraints, that's sort of okay. There are other variants where instead of minimizing a convex quadratic at every time step, which is what we did, so we had a nice closed form solution, you can more generally solve a QP, right? And that would be a way to incorporate state and input constraints. There are also sort of augmented Lagrangian type ideas you can do and so on. So there are sort of constraint variants that just require more machinery than we've talked about. And there are other sort of ideas that are in this space. Like one of the things we worked on somewhat recently is this idea of unscented dynamic programming. So you can sort of think about this idea of propagating a quadratic form through linearized dynamics backwards in time as sort of the backwards version of an EKF, right? So the EKF takes Gaussians and maps them through linear dynamics. And there's sort of other ideas in filtering, like the unscented transform, which takes a bunch of sample points and maps them to the nonlinear dynamics and fits a Gaussian. And you can show that those filters tend to perform a little bit better because they capture some of the higher order information about the dynamics. You can use the same sort of ideas backwards in time to derive different algorithms as well. So there's lots and lots of variants here. It's not quite the sort of situation with like sample-based motion planning where there's a billion variants of like RRTs. It's not quite that extreme, but there are lots of different ideas in the sort of general DDP space. So you can do all kinds of things you would expect. So you can apply this the same algorithm without changing anything to a bunch of different systems, from really simple things to from cart pulls to manipulators, manipulating milk jugs or quadrotors flying through Minecraft forests and the barrel roll that I promised earlier, right? There's some work that you probably have seen from University of Washington. This is an old video now, but using this sort of algorithm for model predictive control. So the idea with model predictive control is, DDP is an algorithm fundamentally that gives you a trajectory and a local tracking controller, right? So you could think about using that as an offline technique, right? I have a walking robot, I want to optimize a walking gait, and I'm just gonna try to track that motion, turn on the robot and track that motion I planned on my desktop computer. If you could solve that problem fast enough though, you could think about completely rerunning the optimization at every control tick, right? And so in that way, you're kind of taking what would normally be a very local policy around a particular trajectory and sort of globalizing it, right? So this is a really powerful idea, and this is something that we're really excited about as well, is trying to find the sort of, what are the right computational mechanisms to make trajectory optimization for complex systems like this, run online for real. One of the things we've sort of been working on very recently is thinking about how to parallelize these algorithms. So you might have noticed that CPUs aren't getting any faster, and that's kind of problematic because, as roboticists, a lot of the problems that we want to solve are just sort of too computationally heavy to do so online. So it's a question of whether we could sort of take advantage of parallel architectures like GPUs in ways that other fields like machine learning have. Now, on its face, DDP and its variants seem highly serial, right? I have this sort of forward simulation from time step zero to time step n, and I have this sequential back propagation of cost-to-go information in time. So in some sense, it doesn't really feel like something we could easily parallelize. There are some parts of the algorithm that are trivially parallelizable. For example, after I forward simulate the dynamics, if I want to compute my sort of Taylor expansion along that entire trajectory, I can do that for every knot point independently, right? That's a completely trivially parallelizable operation. In fact, most of the fast implementation you'll see in the literature do that, but usually on a CPU up to some sort of limit of multi-threading and so on. Another question is, can we modify the algorithm itself to expose more opportunities for parallelism? So, and the answer is sort of yes. And the idea comes from this more general idea of multiple shooting. So let me first explain what the word shooting means. So if you haven't heard this before, this refers to a type of trajectory optimization algorithm, of which DDP is one example, where in order to compute the cost at every iteration, it involves actually simulating the dynamics forward, right? So usually you're representing your decision variables for the optimization as just some input policy and some initial state, and then you can compute the cost through forward simulation, okay? So that's called the shooting method, and that comes, it's a really old word that comes from, you know, back in the day when they're optimizing ballistic trajectories for rockets and things like that. A sort of slight tweak on that idea is multiple shooting, where the idea is, instead of shooting the entire trajectory all at once, I'm gonna break this up into M segments, and then I'm gonna do little mini shooting things, right? So I'll do a sort of forward pass here, and a backwards pass here, and same here, and same here, and same here, and I can do all that in parallel, okay? Now, the downside to that is, normally with a single shooting implementation, I do my forward shot, and then I backpropagate the cost to go information all the way back to this first time step, right? But if I'm doing this in parallel, now I backpropagate to here, right? This guy, at the same time, has some, you know, maybe some stale approximation of what the cost to go actually is, and it's using that to backpropagate and so on. So in order for information to get from this segment sort of requires another iteration in some sense, right? So there's sort of these weird time, information time delay effects that happen when you do a sort of multiple shooting variation of this type of an algorithm. So one of the questions we had was, what's the sort of trade-off here between the number of iterations that you're actually required to find to converge to a solution versus the speed up you'd get by parallelizing this way and putting it on a GPU? So this is something, you know, these are results from like last week, so I was excited to throw them in. So this is a time per iteration in milliseconds for a quad rotor, you know, flying from point A to point B. And here you can see this is a GPU and this is a CPU for different levels of parallelism. So M here is the number of little sub trajectories I'm breaking the thing up into. There's 128 knot points in general. And so you can see on a GPU, as soon as you start to parallelize, you know, it gets really, really fast. So this is about 1 millisecond per entire update of the algorithm across 128 knot points. And then CPU implementations are pretty fast because CPUs are a lot faster than GPUs in general, but they sort of plateau because they run out of threads pretty quickly, okay? Down here, you can see that the sort of cost, the optimization cost versus the number of iterations, how fast that decreases also depends on the degree of parallelism. So if I do M equals one, so completely single shooting, converges very quickly, and then it gets sort of worse and worse as you go. This trend's actually more prominent for a slightly more complicated system, the KUKA arm here. You can see that as I increase parallelism, the sort of convergence gets slower, but the sort of benefits in terms of parallelization compared to a CPU start to get really good. So this is kind of exciting to me, right? So this means we can solve full nonlinear optimization problems over, you know, 64 time steps into the horizon, every iteration for, you know, a millisecond and a half. Yes? Yes, so in general, with multiple shooting, you would write down explicit defect constraints that would enforce that the two states would be equal at convergence, right? So that's sort of one technique, and then you just have like Lagrange multipliers for those constraints that you're also optimizing for. In this case, the convergence of the cost would also sort of ensure that the two points are sort of on top of each other, right? So as long as you have a reasonable convergence tolerance for the algorithm, the beginning of this trajectory and the end of this trajectory are both gonna be sort of at the minimum of that local bowl. Right, so you'll get sort of agreement at convergence, so you don't have to explicitly constrain it, although you could if you wanted. That make sense? So you can get, so you can always get divergence, right? So if you're starting off with gigantic defect constraints, then you can definitely not converge. So this is all subject to, you know, normal caveats of non-convex optimization for sure. Yes. Yes.
These are vessel times for the iterations, right?
This is a single iteration. So everything is just set up and solved on GPU. There's no back and forth with the CPU. Yeah, so everything here just happens on board, doing all kinds of clever memory management, all the stuff you should do. So the sort of takeaway here is you can get really fast convergence. Really fast solve times per iteration, but the convergence goes low. So if you're running this in an MPC scenario where you have pretty good guesses from the previous iteration, then this is actually really attractive, right? Because maybe I only have to run a couple iterations to get, you know, pretty close to the local minima. However, if I'm always running from some completely far away, you know, place, then that's maybe less good, right? So we view this result as being something that's like very attractive from a sort of MPC use case. Yes. Sorry? Say the question again. Yeah, so there's a sort of sync step that happens. So we shoot all these things together, forward, do the backwards pass. And then there's a sync step where I take the cost of approximation from this guy from the previous iteration, and I use that to do the final cost of this guy, right? So that's where the sort of propagation information across all of these happens, right? But it's sort of time delayed because these happen after these parallel forward passes.
Good question. Cool. All right. So that was just an aside that I think, in general, thinking about different ways we can parallelize these algorithms, I think is an exciting idea. Cool. So far we've talked about computing globally optimal policies, thing we'd love to do, infeasible for most robots we care about. Instead, we can settle for locally optimal policies and use ideas from Bellman's equation, from dynamic programming, to design algorithms that compute those local trajectories and feedback controllers to track them very efficiently. Some of the caveats of using this class of methods, so as I mentioned, sort of constraints can be a little bit finicky. They require additional care to implement properly. There are other like really important details that I didn't talk about, like doing line searching on the forward pass and adding regularization to make sure that your quadratic approximation of that Q function is actually convex and so on. And all of these sort of choices really matter. So I have a citation at some point in the slides. You should check out Yuval Tass's thesis. I think he has a really good description of these particular issues in the first chapter. It assumes smoothness of our dynamics, as we mentioned before. And sort of another, not really a problem, but just something to know, it's sort of like the solution technique and the formulation of the problem are kind of fundamentally intertwined. So we're talking about an algorithm more so than a sort of formulation, and what we're going to talk about next is more about how to write down the problem and use sort of generic off-the-shelf solvers to solve it. So this other view of the world is to look at trajectory optimization as just a generic nonlinear program, right? So I'm not exploiting the sort of Markov structure of the problem and using ideas like Bellman's equation. Instead, I'm just going to write down this as just a flat, big nonlinear optimization problem and solve it using standard NLP techniques. So what would that look like? Well, I could take my cost function, which is just the same thing we had before, some additive cost, and now I'm gonna write down a minimization, and now it includes not just the initial state and control tape, where I would normally simulate, you know, to get that state trajectory to evaluate this cost in a shooting method. Now I'm gonna let the solver pick the states and the inputs for every time step, and then I'm gonna add explicit constraints that those states and control inputs satisfy a discrete time representation of the dynamics. Make sense? So this is different than the sort of shooting idea. This is, explicitly representing the dynamics as constraints. And then I can add whatever other cost function, other constraint functions that I want. So I could add, don't walk through walls or whatever, don't fall through the floor, maintain contact with certain points of contact, whatever. There's all the sort of normal task level constraints that you'd want your robot to satisfy are really easy to implement here. The caveat is that these all had better be differentiable, right? Okay, so why do we want to do this instead? Well, oftentimes it's really just a lot easier if you wanted to add lots of constraints to your problem. Sometimes adding lots of constraints actually makes it easier, even though it sounds like it should make it harder. And there's really robust, fast, off-the-shelf solvers that you could just take advantage of. So if you're going to use DDP, unless you can find someone to loan you their DDP implementation, you're basically going to implement that whole thing, debug it, do all the line searching stuff, and to make it work. Where here, you can just think about it more at the formulational level. I can think about what representation of my dynamics I want to use, what the constraints are, what the cost functions are, and then just use the solver as a sort of debugging subroutine. Okay, so pragmatically, I think it's often useful to think about it that way. My group actually likes to think a lot about the internals of solvers and how we could design custom solvers for a special case of trajectory optimization that would perform a lot better to take advantage of special structure that arises in those problems, but not every research group cares about that. And so if you just want to generate trajectories for a robot, then this can be an attractive thing to do. So intuitively, you might have a sort of, to compare what we just talked about in terms of DDP to what we're going to talk about now, you can think about DDP as solving this sort of sequence of small optimization problems that exploit this sort of Markov property and use Bellman's equation to formulate these optimizations, right? So I have these little local quadratic approximations and I'm just looking at how to modify my control at each individual time step in order to jump towards the minimum of that local approximation, right? So I solve a sequence of small problems backwards in time. Now we're talking about writing down a cost function over the entire trajectory. We're gonna still use this kind of idea of building local quadratic approximations to the cost function, but now this function is for all time steps, right? So this is a much higher dimensional thing over here, but the basic idea is the same. It's still a sort of variant of Newton's method to do optimization. So many of the solvers that you'd experience, that you would just download and so on to solve these kind of problems, will you do some kind of variant of sequential quadratic programming. There's lots of details in how to implement this right, but just to give you the high level idea, basically the way it works is I have some initial guess of my trajectory, my states and my inputs through time. I can linearize all my constraint functions and I can quadratize my cost function. And now I have a quadratic program, right? With linear constraints and a quadratic cost, solving quadratic programs is really easy. If you don't have experience in that, it's basically like epsilon harder than a least squares problem, right? This is almost a sort of, it's really easy. So this is why this is often a subroutine for many things. And then you just keep rinsing, repeating, relinearizing, requadratizing, solve a QP, and so on until you converge, or you don't. Right? There's always a possibility with any of the methods I'll talk about today that it just comes back and says no, right? Because non-convexity is hard. And again, if you were to write your own SQP solver, you'd have to learn lots and lots of important tricks, and you can read books like Nocedal and Wright and so on to learn some of those tricks, or you could look at the SNOP documentation. If you want, it's like 100 pages, and just to show you how complex these solvers actually get to be robust for general problems. But most people don't do that, they just run these things. Okay, so just to summarize it, the idea with differential dynamic programming, I'm gonna simulate to compute my state trajectory, and each iteration solve a sequence of small one-step optimizations. SQP is instead going to represent my dynamics as constraints and optimize over both the states and the inputs using a sort of SQP type technique generally. So these are really sort of like two ends of a spectrum you can think about, right? One end, I'm sort of doing this full simulation in shooting, and transcription, I'm just doing these sort of little, maybe like Euler approximations to my dynamics for every single time step. And then there's something that's sort of in the middle where I kind of do little shooting pieces and then little sort of like constraints to make sure that the defects go to zero at convergence and so on, right? So there's really sort of a whole family of problem formulations that have different numerical properties and so on. But they're all sort of related at some high level. So let's look at a different example. So this is the Spring Flamingo. So this is a famous MIT robot from like the 90s. And so it's underactuated. It's sort of connected to a boom here. So it's kind of just walking in a circle. So you can kind of think about it as a planar system. It's got actuators on its hip and knees. It has ankles that are passive springs. And so we can think about, writing down a really simple optimization to try to have it find a cyclic, energetically efficient gate, right? So what would that look like? Well, maybe I could say, I want you to translate from point A to point B while minimizing torque squared, right? It's about the simplest thing you could write down. Okay, I have a task constraint which says get to here, right? I'm gonna force it to get to that position. What do the dynamics constraints look like? Are they gonna be like similar to the robot arm that we saw before or the airplane? Is there something special about these dynamics that we have to take into account? Do you think these dynamics would be continuous, differentiable? What's that? Yeah, right. So contact, right? That's a big deal, right? The sort of fundamental component of this behavior is that it has to make and break contact with the environment. And if I want to think about it as a rigid body system, that means there's discontinuities, right? So that whole step of linearizing my constraints, if my dynamics are sitting in my constraints and they're discontinuous, that's going to be bad, right? So what's a strategy that we can use to solve this kind of a problem inside of that sort of transcription type optimization? So one idea is I can explicitly add contact forces as decision variables and then constrain them to be physical. So you can think about it, I'm allowing the system to choose the contact forces
but then putting constraints on those contact forces such that they actually obey some notion of physics, okay? So one approach would be, well, I'm going to pre-specify what the contact sequence is, when contacts happen, things like that. So it's gonna, you know, be standing on both feet for 5 time steps, and then it's gonna lift its right foot, and then after 20 time steps, it's gonna put its right foot down, and so on, right? So you can, of course, do that. And for a biped, that's not an unreasonable thing to do. But if you're talking about maybe a, you know, a humanoid robot climbing out of a car, which we've actually done in the past, it doesn't work so well, right? Because all kinds of contacts with the, between the butt and the seat and all this stuff, you know, trying to figure that all out ahead of time without even thinking about the dynamics is gonna be really hard. So another approach is to sort of try to let the solver discover the contact sequences for you. So this is an idea called contact implicit optimization. There's lots of different ways to actually implement this, but this is sort of, I'll explain one. So what are the sort of relevant constraints that we want these contact forces to obey? Well, I would like them to obey some friction limits, right? So we tend to use a sort of Coulomb friction model where we can force these contact forces to be within a cone or some conservative polyhedral approximation of a cone, which is often used. I'd also want to make sure that the robot can't go through the ground, right? They should probably explicitly say that. Right, so that this could be a sort of function that maps the configuration of the robot to the sign distance between all the points of contact and the ground, say. And then, given this function, I'd also want to say that the robot can't apply forces, even if they obey friction, if it's not touching the ground, right? That seems like an important requirement. And then, that sort of tells me all of the, these two tell me something sort of about the normal behavior. I also want to say something about what the tangential force should do, right? So usually we'll use an idea like maximum dissipation, which says that if I'm sliding on the ground, that the tangential component of the contact force directly opposes my velocity, right? And that just makes sense, right? If I put my hand on the table and started pushing and sliding it, it'd be weird if friction started helping me, like accelerating me in the direction of motion, right? It's definitely gonna oppose all the motion. It's gonna dissipate energy. So we can explicitly write that as a set of algebraic constraints as well. So what we end up with is an optimization problem that looks like this. So now we have states, inputs, and contact forces for all time steps. We have a cost function. We have a dynamics now that also includes contact forces, right? So this is going to tell me how my state changes as a function of state, input, you know, torques, and external forces. I have these sort of kinematic constraints on not penetrating things in the world, and I have these constraints that I can't apply forces when I'm not touching things, and so on. So what does that look like? Well, if we took our spring flamingo, and I just said, start here, I'm gonna give it an initial guess at the trajectory, which is just a translation, totally unphysical translation. So see, the first iteration is just gonna display that guess trajectory that I provided it, right? So it just sort of translates, doesn't do anything. And then this is an SQP solver actually running, right? So you're gonna see it starts to kind of say, oh, okay, well, I need to get from point A to point B, but I also have to satisfy all these constraints. So it starts to make itself more and more physical over time, which is kind of cool. And you're seeing it's doing all kinds of crazy contacts, right? Because it's, you know, we're letting it decide when and how it should make contact. So it does this crazy tap dancing stuff initially, where it's sort of almost dithering across the ground. And then eventually it sort of finds trajectories that look more and more reasonable. And if we let this go 50 iterations, you get something that looks like this. It's kind of pretty, right? It's some slight weirdness in the foot and so on because it's got springs and whatever. But it's doing a nice pendulum-like swinging motion where it's clearly trying to minimize energy while obeying physics. Nope, they're continuous. Yep, so the discreteness of the contact, which means the sort of discreteness of contact comes when you're either touching something or not touching something. And that's captured by these constraints here, which says basically that if my contact force is non-zero, then my distance to the ground had better be zero, right? Likewise, if my distance to the ground is non-zero, my force had better be zero. So that sort of discreteness that's fundamental to contact is captured in these constraints, which are called complementarity constraints. Okay? So it's just a different way to capture the sort of integerness of contact. Any other questions about this? Cool. We have one more example. Using the same algorithm, now we just have a slightly more complicated robot. So this is another old robot, little dog. And it's higher dimensional, so it's got 36 states. And again, it's just saying minimize torque squared, obey physics, get from here to here. And so it comes up with this, you know, sequence of
foot locations that sort of gets it up onto the step. And because contact forces are decision variables, I could do things like apply cost to them, right? So here, you know, we applied a cost on the front foot. So this would be like, maybe it's got a splinter in its front left foot or something like that. So it kind of comes up with a gate where it kind of favors that foot, which is, I don't know, pretty pointless, but kind of fun. Okay, so something happened between talking about DDP and talking about these direct transcription methods. Our sort of outputs got less cool. And they got less cool because not only, so with DDP, we got both a nominal trajectory and a feedback controller for tracking that trajectory. In direct transcription, we just got out a nominal trajectory, right? That's not good because if I just took that nominal trajectory and executed open loop, even in simulation, it's gonna fail miserably, right? So you can think about, okay, well, I have some, you know, set point trajectory, I can design a PID controller to track it. That's totally fine. People do that all the time. I wouldn't, you know, wanna push away from doing that. However, a slightly more elegant, in my opinion, way to do that control design around a trajectory is to use a linear quadratic regulator. And let's talk about that right now. So this is gonna be another optimization, and it's gonna take as input and actually a locally optimal trajectory from, you know, some trajectory optimization, for example. So this is gonna be some trajectory optimization that goes from, some trajectory that runs from time zero to n. And there, the first thing we're gonna do is linearize the nonlinear dynamics around that trajectory. So here we're defining a new coordinate system, which is, you know, states relative to my planned trajectory, right? And so now this is just some standard time-varying linear dynamics. I can define a tracking cost, which is quadratic, where I'm gonna, these sort of Q and R matrices are gonna tell me sort of trade-off how much I care about forcing the system back to the nominal trajectory versus minimizing my control input or deviations from my nominal input, to be more specific. In general, these costs are gonna be different than the ones that we use to generate the trajectory, right? They don't have to be the same. So what we'd like as an output is a tracking controller that works in the vicinity of the planned trajectory, right? So that's the whole point of this. So we've done, this is a two-step process now. We run trajectory optimization, get a trajectory. Now we're gonna do this additional optimization to compute a controller along it. So we have some special structure here. We have a quadratic cost. Before we decided that quadratic costs were kind of nice because, you know, in the context of DDP, it would make doing the quadrization slightly simpler. But if I were to try to say my value function was a quadratic, just because my cost was quadratic, that really wouldn't fly because I had nonlinear dynamics sitting in the way, right? Now we have this sort of time-varying linear dynamics and a quadratic cost. So maybe we should take a step back and go to our dynamic programming place again and see if this admits a nice closed form solution, okay? So it's the return of Bellman. So we can start by saying the sort of algebraic argument that we made before. We say at time step n, there's nothing we're gonna do. We just look at what the state is and we, you know, multiply it through our final cost. In this case, it's quadratic cost. Pretty straightforward. At some other time step k, of course, we're gonna always have that the Bellman equation is satisfied. And in that case, it's gonna be something that looks like this, where it's again just sort of our one step cost plus the minimum over u of the one step cost on u, and then the value function at the following state and time step. It turns out that because the dynamics are linear, v star will actually be a quadratic form, which is fantastic, right? So there's gonna be some S matrix, which is a function of time, which is going to define the optimal cost to go under an optimal policy for that time-varying linear system. How do we compute that S? Well, basically you would just, you know, set the derivative equals zero, do some algebra, blah, 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 and you get out this thing, right? Which is called the Riccati equation, very well known. You should, you know, if you're interested in this kind of stuff, I would recommend actually deriving this yourself. It's very straightforward and satisfying once you get to the end. But in practice, this is a really simple thing to compute. So computing this value function, again, for the time-varying linear system and that quadratic cost that we defined is a pretty procedural process. So here's how it works. We set the final cost equal to, cost to go at the final time step equal to the final cost matrix, and then iterate backwards in time, just computing S at the previous time step until we get to time zero. And then we're gonna compute a feedback matrix the following way, and then we get a nice linear feedback controller that'll give us our optimal input U for every state. Now, we just did dynamic programming, not differential dynamic programming, right? Full-blown dynamic programming. So is this a global feedback policy? A globally optimal feedback policy? I see some shaking heads. Yeah? Yes. So it's sort of a trick question. It is the globally optimal feedback policy for the time-varying linear system, right? But that's only an approximation to our actual dynamics around the nominal trajectory. So in practice, this is only really gonna perform well when you're sort of close to the trajectory such that linearization is a reasonable approximation to your dynamics, right? Very important. Cool. So how do we use this in practice? Well, I could take a trajectory that we can optimize using a direct transcription method for Atlas running, right? So this is, you know, putting contact forces in the optimization, running an optimization to find a running gate, and then strapping an LQR controller around it, executing the LQR controller, and now we have a closed loop system that can do a really fancy dynamic behavior despite the system's high dimensional complexity, right? So this is putting together tools for finding locally optimal solutions that allow it to scale to a high dimensional system. You know, computing a global feedback policy for the nonlinear system for running would be extremely hard, right? But thankfully you don't really have to do that. If you were only given these tools, how could you think about building a more global feedback policy? Any thoughts on that? What would you do? Forget about running. Suppose I had, you know, the Acrobat, and I designed a trajectory that could swing from the bottom up to the top, and it had a nice little LQR control around it. But if I try to run that LQR controller from starting from like this position, the arm's gonna flip out and do nothing useful, right? So what might you do? Maybe run trajectory optimization again from here, right? Build another LQR controller, right? And then you can imagine tiling the entire space with trajectories and local feedback controllers. Right, so people have done this in various different ways. So that's one way you can think about building up global policies. They're not globally optimal anymore, right? But they're sort of globally good enough. Like the other algorithms we talked about, there's lots of variants of LQR. So there's slightly different, Riccati equations that would show up depending on you're doing infinite horizon, finite horizon, discrete, or continuous dynamics. In practice, there's actually just a command in MATLAB called LQR, which takes in A and B, your linearization matrices from your dynamics, and Q and R, your cost functions, and gives you back both the S matrix and your feedback matrix for the controller, which is pretty handy. You can think about, you know, applying these sort of techniques to systems that have, you know, manifold constraints, right? If I wanted a balancing robot that kept both feet on the ground, this sort of this kinematic null space that I have to remain within, so you can do sort of projection techniques to apply it there. There are hybrid variants that, you know, allow you to do these sort of controls through hybrid discontinuous events, and so on. Cool. So to summarize, I hope I've convinced you that dynamics matter, and they're not that bad, right? So many of the tasks that we care about solving, especially in things like locomotion, the task specification is sort of intimately tied together with the dynamics of the system. So it's a complete necessity that we have control techniques and optimization techniques that can design controllers that work with the dynamics of the system in order to achieve the goals that we set for the system. Most of the ideas that I've talked about actually have a long history outside of the robotics literature. While they're being used and expanded upon more and more in recent years in robotics, you know, most ideas like DDP and trajectory optimization go back well into the 60s, 70s, and so on. Some of those even before that. So it's worth sort of getting that kind of context if you start diving into these methods. We talked about this way to view all these, this family of trajectory optimizations as sort of a spectrum that runs from shooting type techniques, of which DDP is one kind, to sort of multiple shooting techniques, which are somewhat something of a middle ground between full transcription methods that apply constraints on the dynamics every time step and shooting techniques that simulate the full system. And in this sort of realm of multiple shooting, you can start thinking about ideas like parallelization and to make these algorithms run really fast and potentially online. One of the things that I tried to do was start really basic with dynamic programming and show you the ways which this sort of very simple and general algorithm that doesn't scale well leads to scalable algorithms that do specific things. In the case of DDP, doing local trajectory optimization. In the case of, you know, time-varying LQR, building feedback controllers around trajectories that someone hands to you. So there's sort of this idea of dynamic programming that runs through a lot of these methods that I think is worth pointing out. Contact constraints are a really big deal, and most of the systems that we work with, you know, all of us here and certainly in my group as well, interacting dynamically and effectively with the environment is a real important feature of high-performance robots. And you might notice that a lot of robots, even state-of-the-art robots, tend to avoid contact with their world, right? So they sort of play a game of operation where they kind of go through environments only carefully touching things with their hands and their feet. You know, you don't see robots that pick up grocery bags and use like their arms against their torso and things like that. And I think a lot of that reason is computational, right? So thinking about ways that we could deal with, you know, surface contacts, many contacts, and reasoning about the dynamic effects of these interactions is really computationally hard. So I showed you sort of one type of technique to think about that in the context of trajectory optimization, but there's lots of other problems there that arise when you start thinking about feedback control through contact, generalizing estimation algorithms to deal with discontinuous events and so on. So there's still lots of work to be done, especially in the sort of contact regime. And so this, I just started to throw this video in. This is part of the DRC team when I was here as a postdoc. And this was Atlas climbing out of a Polaris Ranger, which he could barely fit into, and sort of balancing on one foot. And so you can see our strategy here was to, again, make the robot sort of not really touch anything and just use its really, really fancy continuous dynamic balance controller to achieve the task. But, you know, we're trying to make this a better story going forward. Thanks. Happy to take any questions. Yes. Yeah, so, you know, one of the obvious places where structure shows up in this kind of a problem, this is where slide builds come back to haunt you. Okay, so, let's see, so if I were to look at this particular problem, solve a QP, well, suppose there were no constraints, you know, minimizing a quadratic is going to involve inverting that quadratic form. Same kind of thing happens inside of QP solvers. There's more stuff that happens to deal with constraints too. But fundamentally, you want to invert these matrices, right? So if I want to invert a matrix with block diagonals, you know, structure, then there's smart ways to do that, and there's dumb ways to do that. So that would be one example. And so it turns out SNOPT in particular is a solver that's designed to sort of identify those sparsity patterns and take advantage of them automatically in some sense, right? So that's sort of one way. Another way is rather than solving SQP problems, so let me try to give you an example why SQP might not be the best thing for robot control. So suppose I wanted to optimize a trajectory that gets me from here to here, subject to not penetrating the podium, all right? What's SQP gonna do? SQP is gonna say, well, okay, I want you to get from here to here, don't go through here. So this is a constraint that it linearizes. It's going to stick a plane right here. And then I'm going to, you know, optimize my trajectory, maybe smash into that plane. And maybe if the solver is smart enough and it perturbs the solution, I can kind of maybe get myself around it. Or maybe I get stuck. And depending on the geometry of these constraints, maybe it's actually like a bug trap or whatever. Another approach, which comes from sort of method of multiplier methods, is instead to say, well, I'm going to put a penalty in for this constraint as a cost function. And then I'm going to incrementally update my estimate of the Lagrange multiplier so that at convergence, I'm satisfying my constraints to very high tolerance. But during the solve, I'm allowed to violate my constraints, you know, to some degree. So that the solution trajectory for that might look more like flying through this podium, violating the constraint, and then incrementally fixing it because the cost on violating that constraint is going up over time, right? So that class of solvers might actually be better for the kinds of non-convexity that often show up in robot planning problems. So that's another example. Yeah, so you're saying, what if there's a couple different layers of that. One is your dynamics that you're using here just doesn't match, right? You're missing like friction or like compliance effects or something that's real in the physical system that's not in your rigid body approximation. That's certainly a problem. And so one way to think about that is to ignore it, right? Use some nominal model and use the fact that, you know, LQR feedback gives you some inherent robustness. So as long as your errors aren't huge, maybe the feedback will just take care of it for you. So that's sort of one school of thought, right? And that's usually try that first, and if that doesn't fail, get fancier, right? The next thing you could do is to try to characterize the errors in your model, right? So say maybe I have bounded errors in my inertia estimates joint friction estimates or something like that, right? And then try to optimize trajectories against that sort of set of disturbances, right? So I could say, what might be the closed loop variance of my system under this set of disturbances and minimize the volume of the distribution of states that I would visit, right? So one of the things we've done recently is to try to, that's a very hard problem to solve in general. It makes, you know, this nonlinear problem even worse. But there are sort of nice approximations that you can do to make it sort of tractable and give it some ability to reason about robustness and things like that. That's roughly what I would say. Yeah. Yep.
So that you're considering contact constraints for any manipulation stuff.
Yep.
So what kind of scenarios are you trying to work?
Yeah. So I think manipulation is a harder case to justify all the fancy dynamic contact stuff. You know, it has to involve sort of like impacts or some fast motion or things like that. You know, the sad truth is for many of the manipulation tasks that people work on, you know, just picking something up, moving point A to point B, you know, dynamics don't matter that much. You're doing something as roughly forced closure or whatever, and you don't have to worry about it, right? So I think it's a fair point. Like one of the problems that I've pitched to some of my grad students and they got scared immediately was buy one of those outdoor Jenga sets and have a robot that could learn how to play Jenga by sort of interacting with the blocks and pulling out the ones that feel loose and things like that. So it's doing some sort of sophisticated estimation of like the, you know, the friction of the block and things like that in a closed loop. So I don't know. I think there are problems. I think finding the ones that are you know, super like industrially relevant and would require like really sophisticated dynamic modeling is, you know, there's not a lot of those problems, I think. But it's certainly an easier case to make for like whole body control, acrobatics, walking, that kind of thing. Karis? Yeah, so it depends on the robot, right? So it's usually, you know, function of the hardware. So like the KUKA arm, it's usually doing some kind of position control. We do have some sort of inverse dynamics method. So basically the idea would be I would send a feed forward torque, but then there would be some light, you know, PD control on the outside that hopefully has lower gain than I would otherwise have to have or wanted to do, you know, high precision position control. For walking robots, we usually use just torque. We just send torques to the motors, and we're just doing, you know, solving convex optimization problems to compute those torques on the fly. For Atlas, it was a hydraulic robot and had lots of friction in the hydraulic seals and limited ability to actually measure joint force. So we ended up doing some mixture of velocity feedback and feed forward torque control. So it was a little bit like a higher impedance version of torque control, things like that. So it really just depends on the hardware. Yep.
In the, I guess, optical broken in the
Yes.
How do you guarantee that you design the correct minimum?
Don't. Yeah, so I think that, you know, those of you who have played with these methods in practice realize that it's pretty easy to come up with really poor solutions, right? So there's often a little bit of iteration that happens between the experimenter and the formulation where you might be adding additional cost terms or changing the weighting of costs and things like this, right, in order to encourage, you know, reliable convergence to the kind of solution that you want. But, you know, I think, you know, it's generally a problem, right? And there's no sort of theoretical way you're going to get away from it because these problems just are non-convex. So the one thing you could think about doing is replacing the human smarts, right, that has to sit there and manually tweak this stuff. Maybe there could be, you know, learning algorithms that could be used to generate warm starting solutions that would lead to more reliable solvers. I think this is going to be more and more important as these solvers start running on, you know, in control loops, right, where if it just says, oh, can't find a solution, that's really bad, right, because the robot's going to fall over. So I think there's, you know, maybe interesting opportunities there. Yes. So usually for humanoids that are meant to do many things and be robust against like failures like that, we'd usually try to think about that as having some kind of state machine of behaviors that we've more or less computed offline, right? So there may be strategies for coordinating arms and legs to get yourself into some known initial configuration and then executing some kind of, you know, get up routine or something like that. So that would be a highly practical way to do that. I think, in general, just, you know, laying on the ground and running trajectory optimization on the fly to get back up is probably not going to work that well. I don't know. Not yet, anyway. Yeah.
And you also presented the derivative-free methods for quadratic programming.
Yep.
Is it also online and real-time?
We haven't made that one real-time yet. Yep. So that paper, we wrote everything in MATLAB, and it was running, like, offline. But the way that it gets around computing derivatives is by using sampling, right? So you can think about, so the unsaid transform is using a bunch of sample points around some nominal and then running that through the nonlinear dynamics and, you know, and fitting a quadratic form. Whereas the other way, we're sort of like computing a quadratic form, linearizing dynamics and mapping it through the linear dynamics normally, right? So that sort of running those sample points through the nonlinear dynamics is something that's completely parallelizable. So in some sense, I think that algorithm would be even more amenable to these sort of GPU techniques than the other one was. Yep. How do I design the cost function? That's a big question. So yeah, I mean, it's an important one, right? So where do, you know, likewise in reinforcement learning, right, where do reward functions come from in optimal control or pessimist? So we talk about costs, where do those come from? Yeah, and in some cases, it's really nice. You can write down something that's very pure, like minimize torque squared and put some constraint on some state you want to get to, and the system is such that leads to the kind of solution you want. More often than not, you know, if I wanted to optimize a, you know, a bipedal walking gait and said, go from here to here and minimize energy, well, it's probably going to come up with a swing trajectory that clears the floor by like a millimeter, right? Because why waste all kinds of energy doing this? But we know that that's sort of not robust, right? If I had any sort of noise in my estimation of where the ground was, that robot's going to stub its toe and probably fall over, right? So I think, you know, people often add cost functions and say, I actually make the clearance of the foot also this, and minimize torque, and do this, and then we, you know, get into this weird balance of cost functions that that sort of describe a particular behavior kind of well, but sort of where that came from is who knows. So I think coming up with general techniques that you could, you know, from a high-level specification of behavior, spit out a optimization problem that, if solved, would locally lead to solutions that satisfy that specification, would be amazing. I think it's a really hard problem, but that's the sort of thing that we would love to have. Yep. So you're talking about the multiple shooting thing, And so the thing that happens is, if the algorithm converges, the end of segment M and the beginning of segment M plus one are on top of each other, right? There's no discrepancy there. Then the algorithm didn't converge. Potentially, right? So I'd have to think about what value that would add in practice, but I think there's certainly lots of opportunities to add sort of explicit stochasticity into these kinds of algorithms. There's pretty natural ways to do it in the case of DDP. And think about optimizing sort of robust objectives where you're not just minimizing, you know, expected performance, but maybe expected performance plus one standard deviation or something like that, right? So I think there's lots of opportunity to do that kind of thing. Yeah. Yes. Yes. So, okay. So,
this key function has what it has.
X gets mapped through the dynamics, so through the chain rule, that means I have to take derivatives of my dynamics as well, right? So the derivative of Q with respect to X is going to involve, as part of the chain rule, the derivative of F with respect to X, right? Now, if I do the second derivative of Q with respect to X, that's going to involve E squared F, E X squared, right? And so, and that's going to just show up as an additional term in the Taylor expansion, right? Right? So all iterative LQR does is delete that term. And then you can see that you're, effectively what you're doing is approximating the Hessian using only Jacobians, which is theoretically very similar to the idea of Gauss-Newton methods in nonlinear optimization. So instead of explicitly computing the Hessian of the cost, you're computing an iterative approximation to the Hessian and then using that for minimization. And effectively, the algorithm is still gonna work just fine. The theoretical convergence is not going to be quadratic anymore, it's going to be superlinear, okay? So the thing, just to close the loop on this idea, this derivative-free idea, so the problem is we're sort of losing our second order estimation of the cost by doing iterative LQR, but it still works, it's converges slowly. The idea here was by using an unsanded transform, we're capturing a little bit of that sort of higher order information through the sampling technique, through the nonlinear dynamics. And so you can show that for some problems, convergence rate of DDP looks like this, ILQR looks like this, and this algorithm is right in the middle. Okay. So it's a sort of nice middle ground between the two.
Thank you.
Yep. Other questions? Okay. Well, thanks for having me.
So there's a break with some refreshment until 3, and let's meet at 3 in the class 124 for the last.